Hello, and welcome to the audio commentary for the film Creepshow. My name is Michael Felsher, and I will be moderating, if that's the word, this commentary tonight.
That's a good word.
Yeah. Just get in the way.
Well, yeah, no, thanks. See, that's already, it's off to a wonderful start.
Already Michael is taking shit here.
Yeah, so we have two gentlemen in the room here, and who's here with me right now?
Freaking garbage now.
Tom Savini.
George Romero.
And, well, and then that's all we need to
and
say.
And Stephen King is in here in spirit.
He's in spirit, yes, he is.
Right. And there's his son, Joe King. This boy is, the boy in this scene is played by Stephen's son, Joe. Him.
With a slap mark. Did we do that?
You must have.
You must have. Yeah.
Unless you just did a lot of takes.
Unless we just smacked him.
Yeah, he was like, this was like take 14.
Yes. He's tired of being smacked around.
Tommy Atkins, Pittsburgh guy.
Isn't Joe King like a filmmaker now or something? Didn't you tell me something like that?
He's well. You saw him at a show last year. He walked up to your table and it was Joe King. He looks just like his dad now.
Yeah.
Good. Wow.
Yeah.
Comic book. You have the comic book, right?
Rick Catazone has the
but
one.
Did you shoot the comic book?
Yeah, we shot the pages in the
comic.
Yeah.
So they'll be able to see that.
Oh yeah, the actual hand penciled in comic and everything. I think that was just a prop that someone actually has that prop because it's still curled up the way Tom was holding it.
You see that crap? All that horror crap.
Ivor Jean. Tom Atkins, man, he was living in L.A. and moved back to Pittsburgh. He did a bunch of work in L.A., did a couple of John Carpenter things, and moved back to the Berg.
And he worked with you a couple times later on Bruiser and...
He was in Bruiser and he was in several.
He does a lot of public theater in Pittsburgh too.
Oh yeah. So the opening story segues to anime. So now we're about to see one of your creations.
Raul.
See, I didn't remember that was. His Raul. Name was Raul.
Yeah, we named everything. Raul, he's a real skeleton. He's a real skeleton, and when he arrived in the box had a product of India. It was a real skeleton, and we hid all the mechanisms in the skeleton, so we were hoping when the lightning flashed, you could see through the skeleton, so that's why we hid everything.
But you couldn't see through it.
Well, he was... Yeah. Carpet on.
His robes
he was
on.
Dressed in the carpet, you know.
And this is all animation from by Rick Catazone from and the animators in Pittsburgh. And I always thought these credits ran too fast. Not enough time on each one of them.
They are quick. They dissolve really
very quick.
Very quickly, yes.
How old Adrian Barr, Fritz Wah, Leslie.
Carrie Nye,
she just passed away.
Yeah.
She passed away, I think, last summer.
Dick Cavett's wife.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a couple people aren't with us anymore. It's a shame E.G. Marshall's not around. Boy, I tell you, I remember him from 12 Angry Men. You know, the old one sitting in the Met.
They called him E.G.
E.G.?
E.G.
Oh, they called him E.G.?
On the set. E.G., yeah.
Ivica Lindfors passed away some time ago.
Father's Day.
This was shot in a house in Pittsburgh. It was an actual house.
It's a real house owned by some guy that made wigs. I mean, it was a hairdresser.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Dom Abbott, I think, was his name.
This is the Abbott house.
Yeah.
Abbott's mansion. The guy was real... persnickety, I guess.
Really?
Yeah. I remember one day later on, when Nate's corpse is walking around, the set decorator put muddy footprints on the floor. And he came in one day and, "What the hell are you guys doing?" And wanted to mop up the footprint. No, that's
it's part of the show.
Hot set. Yeah. Hot set. You know.
Coming out. Cass hasn't told you about Ducky Old
Green. Warner Shook. Pulitzer Prize winning.
Yeah, how about
Warner
that?
Warner Shook.
Warner Shook is a director of plays and who won the Pulitzer for Kentucky Cycle. Carrie Nye. And
here comes Viv.
Vivica sort of corrupted her character. She had her own way with it, you know. Steve, I think, didn't like it very much.
Oh, really?
Yeah. John Lorimer.
I remember him from a Star Trek episode, For the World is Hollow and I've Touched the Sky, and I swear he looked the same then as he does in this.
Yeah.
I mean, it was just like...
And Ed Harris, man, we'd worked with Ed in a film called Knight Riders, and Ed was about to get his big break, which was playing John Glenn in The Right Stuff, but he hadn't gotten it yet, and so he agreed to do this, and so it was like old times.
He only made one movie, well, before Knight Riders. It was borderline Charles Bronson movie.
Oh, yeah.
He was the bad guy.
The point is...
We decided to try to do all these opticals and, you know, to make it more comic booky.
Mm-hmm.
The frames around things and all that. That jagged frame. And
that was the guy who falls back in the water was my assistant, Daryl Ferrucci.
Oh, yeah.
17-year-old Daryl.
Playing a 75-year-old guy getting shot in the
head. Just to fall back in the water.
And that's the marble ashtray.
Oh, yes.
Which theoretically appears, and we shot it. That marble ashtray appears somewhere in each of the stories in this movie.
We should make it a point to try to find it.
We should try to find it.
So we can actually,
I think maybe it got cut out of...
Well, I know it's
at least one of them.
It's the soap dish and they're creeping up on you.
Yeah.
And it's also, I believe it's on Hal Holbrook's dresser in the crate.
Isn't it sitting next to Stephen King? And
yeah, it's sitting on, yeah, it's, I think it's sitting next to his chair.
Yeah, but where is it in something to tide you over? It may not be there. It may have been cut out.
I don't think it's in Richard's house. I think
and
it's
I was
in,
the editor of Something to Tide You Over, so I cut it out!
Is it in Ted Danson's
I think it's
apartment?
In Ted Danson's apartment, if I'm not sure. We'll find out when we get there. We're going to probably be proven horribly wrong.
The audience has to find the ashtray.
The ashtray.
Where's Waldo?
Yeah.
Waldo the ashtray.
No, it was on the beach. I was like, wait a minute, what?
Well, the idea was to put it, we had this wacky idea to put that ashtray in each of the stories, and we did. I don't know if it survived in each of them.
Why?
Well, I don't know. I edited Something to Tide You Over. Maybe I cut it out myself.
No, I mean, why would you decide to put it in all the episodes?
It was a silly idea.
Just a
silly
little gimmick?
Something for the fans to look for. And this was, you know, before video was as big as it is, right? But...
You know, you never think people are going to go back and obsess over where the ashtray is.
No. We were hoping that they would just buy tickets and come to the theater again.
You don't think much after that.
I get emails on where's the ashtray.
You do.
I wanted to buy the ashtray.
And listen to the Foley on this, man. This was the first time that I even knew what Foley was. And all the footsteps and little jingling of her jewelry and all of that.
Oh, yeah. It's all in. That's the first time
it's
you really worried
about
it. It's
all done on a soundstage somewhere by Foley artists. I didn't even know what Foley was. But...
So this is just the backyard of this house that you turned into a cemetery.
Yeah.
It was a huge, huge estate. Guy had horses.
Vivica, boy, she's still good looking. But Steve was very upset with the way she took liberties with this role. I mean, she made it her own.
She just
basically
totally
designed her own wardrobe. And
I love that you got the cake and there's a cake frame around it. And
but this oval was meant to presage the oval in the kitchen doorway later, which you see later.
Oh, okay.
Her name, the housekeeper there.
Mrs. Danvers?
Danvers.
Yeah.
Was that...
Danvers, yeah.
Because of Rebecca?
Rebecca.
Uh-huh.
Well, you got to ask Stephen about that one, but yeah, I'm sure it is. I'm sure he was thinking of that.
A little homage to the Hitchcocks.
Yeah.
Played by... Oh, in Rebecca.
Mrs. Oh, Joan Fontaine? Or no, the, oh, it was Dame Judith Anderson.
Yeah.
And wasn't it the witch's mother? What's her name? Who was the mother of the witch in Bewitched?
Agnes Moorehead.
Lava.
Now this has become a trivia contest of stuff. Who played what and where?
Wasn't Mrs. Danvers who played
Agnes Moorehead?
Agnes Moorehead.
Wasn't it Agnes Moorehead?
No, I think you're right.
No, it was Judith Anderson. In fact, I believe she won an Oscar for that.
Oh, Judith Anderson?
Yeah, for that part, yeah. The film won Best Picture, but Alfred Hitchcock did not win Best Director. It was the only film of his that ever won Best Picture.
Who has that tombstone?
I don't know who has that tombstone, but I know that one of the tombstones is in Bamba's basement. I saw
which
it.
Which one?
It's one
you
actually.
Just picked a random tombstone.
Actually, I think we see it later when Ed Harris wanders back out. That tombstone still exists, but I don't know who has Nathan Grantham's. I know where a lot of the props for this movie are.
I had it in me. I'm your daughter, right?
Because a lot of this was improv, or just here sitting here.
Well, it was, obviously there was a script that Stephen had written, but Vivica just took off on it, went off, did her own thing.
Huh?
Called her father every name in the book, and, it was just...
Yeah, she's just having it out with him right there.
Yeah.
She's great.
I mean, she's totally, completely into it.
Oh, yeah.
I'm saying, man, this is fab.
She's excising demons.
Oh, yeah. Her yearly constitutional. She comes here just to yell and scream at her miserable old dad.
Yeah.
Of course, this year's going to be a little bit different. So you actually, Tom, you had a hole built there, right there in front of the grave, and
yeah, I don't know if it did. We do it right there. We actually had to dig a hole in the ground in front of the grave so that the corpse could come scratching his way up out of it.
John Amplis.
Yeah.
Actually, it's interesting that the booze brings him back after all these Father's Days. What is he, Irish?
Yeah. It's like, all it takes is a little booze.
A little booze in the soil.
We'll come up and kill everybody.
And he comes back to life.
Look at you see, this is a diopter shot. In other words, they split the focus on so that the fan would be in focus when it came up.
Ah. Well, there's two or three guys in that hole besides John Amplis. One guy with the smoke machine. Some I think Ed Fountain might be down there doing the lights. Or
Marty did a lot of lights on this too.
But the guy in the makeup is John Amplis, the guy who played Martin in a film we made called Martin.
Except when there's a close-up of the maggots, then Debbie Pintus got in the costume because John didn't want maggots to crawl on him.
Is that right?
So we grabbed Debbie Pintus and she let the maggots crawl on her. And she eventually became one of the bug handlers in
Creepshow?
Yeah,
the later part that they're creeping up on you?
Yeah.
And oh, here's Ed's, this is Ed's wonderful dance. This is the best. I mean, this is,
that's hard to do.
That's got
to
be on
how do you look cool, dancing in front of the crew? And
I suppose. All I know is it definitely should be when AFI does their tribute to him, I'm sure at some point that should open it. It's his dancing.
That's good. Do you believe this? I mean,
yeah.
Ed is the most serious sort of, considered kind of guy, and here he is, like, rocking at.
While we were shooting this, the guy who owned the place, Abbott, his German Shepherd died.
Yeah.
And the dog is buried in that hole that Nate came out of.
So it's...
So the hole served a purpose.
It did.
Yeah.
It was.
So don't say that, we movie makers...
it's practical.
And in the next Creepshow, someone's going to go visit the grave and the dog's going to come back and attack and kill the person, Ed's gonna die.
Well, you know he's gonna die when he lights a smoke.
Well, he went off on it.
All he needs to do is start whistling Dixie.
Although it fools people now when they watch the movie because, of course, Ed's a huge actor. People think, well, of course they're not gonna kill off Ed Harris now.
Well, they killed Janet Leigh, didn't they?
Yeah. But now people are just like, oh man, they just squashed him.
Ed's great. He made me cry in the Abyss.
Oh, right.
Oh,
yeah.
It's amazing. He's a wonderful actor.
Brought me to tears on that one. I still haven't seen Pollock. I own it, but I haven't watched
it
yet.
It's really wonderful.
He keeps trying to, he keeps trying to, make it real. And I kept saying, Ed, it's not real. Not meant to be real. Don't worry about hiking up your pants. Don't worry about any of them. But you know what? It all works. You never think twice about any of it.
Do you see him in History of Violence?
Saw Cronenberg's movie. Yeah.
Do you see him in Beethoven? Do you see him in?
I missed that one.
No.
Oh boy.
I try to see everything he's in. Did you saw him on the inside the actor studio when he goes off on Knight Riders? You know, they didn't even show that in the finished thing, but he
Knight Riders, yay!
And people in the audience, students, had seen it and were with him.
Oh, that's excellent. Yeah. Oh, that's excellent.
Well, he made a film last year called Copying Beethoven, and there's a he plays Beethoven. I mean, check that out.
Wow.
But he does this wonderful job, and there's a sequence in there. Well, I can't go into details on it now, but it's this wonderful sequence where the orchestra plays the fifth, and the musicians didn't want to do it because he was deaf, and this woman who was his copyist and who was secretly in love with him.
Wow.
conducts basically from a hidden place behind the orchestra, and it's just it's one of the greatest sequences in film. He's and Ed is fabulous.
Well, he's he always seems to commit so thoroughly to whatever part it is he's playing.
Well, he did, man.
Even in Knight Riders, tears, real tears, man. You know.
Well, when he turns over the crown. I mean, everybody. Oh. There wasn't anybody on the set that was.
Richard Rubenstein was crying. You know, it was. But you know what? You just walked up to us one day and said, "Oh, we're going to do the crowning this afternoon." What crowning? I had no idea we were going to shoot that. And that's what helped make it, I think, so emotional, because we weren't ready. Boom, and then the queen hands the crown over. Supercharged.
Uh-oh.
What now?
Look at Ed. You know what? He did that shot. That's so un-Ed Harris. That eyes, you know, make the eyes roll.
The big exaggerated old eye roll.
I was saying to him, do the exaggerated eye thing. Look at the hand and, like, seem afraid.
Let's all do the sound when the tombstone hits them, okay? Yeah. It's a pretty good sound effect.
It was a really squishy hit.
Ed does it.
It's very juicy.
You at home, go with it and do the sound with us, you know, from now on. This will become the Rocky Horror of the
Right. Exactly. Have some friends over and everybody do the sound right at that moment.
And look for the ashtray.
Well, this is the type of movie you're supposed to do that with.
Where is the ashtray, the real ashtray?
Beats me. I think Tasso or Chris Stavrakis has it.
Well, I know he borrowed it and made copies of it.
Yeah, he's selling them for like on eBay for like
$300 was the last one. I saw it, yeah.
Wondershook has some good lines in this one. I like the line right before the last line, I think, really is, are we conserving energy?
Right. Droll.
Yeah, very. It's very, very funny.
He's perfect casting.
Warner is droll. It is perfect casting. Actually, he went to school with my wife at the time, Christine, and
go get him.
I've known him for years. But Warner, this character is exactly. He's also in Knight Riders. He plays Pippin, the guy
he's in Dawn, too.
He plays a zombie in Dawn.
Blew his brains out.
A bit of an effete zombie, but, you know, it comes across. With that fake beard that you put on him.
Did I?
You put a fake beard on Warner.
Well, just to make him look different?
Just to make him look different.
We were indulging ourselves on that movie. Every day was Halloween on that movie.
And then here's the oval window back, and
this is so the early ovals were presaging.
Ovals are evil in this one.
The recurring ovals,
and then this is
doing.
So I thought that would be a real shocker. And it never really worked. It shouldn't have been all blue. Now look at this. Look. There's another sound we can all do. But this thing of her on the tray, later, when he comes in with her head on the tray, Tom, you remember that? Trying to make the for it, make it look, because she was actually...
She's there.
She's kneeling
on the floor. I think there was some black cloth in front of her.
Yeah, a picture of that. Yeah, it's all black
cloth. And we used her real head, just made it look like her severed head.
But if you see this with the wrong resolution, or if you brighten the screen too much, you can see the black cloth.
Oh, really?
And it bums out the whole effect.
Look, I just want to get another bottle of wine.
But you'll see it in a minute.
All right. I think we'll see the muddy footprints in here shortly as well.
Oh, sure. The ones that... So you got to clean these up.
The guy wanted to clean up, yeah. Stop!
Oh, yeah, here comes Warner's Rosebud. Disturbing energy.
Uh-oh.
The oval again.
The oval again. Oh,
the
muddy footprints.
The muddy footprints.
That Dom Abbott was so upset by. We did clean up. Over there. See, now there's a cloth there. And if you brighten your screen, you can see the cloth. Because it actually is Gary. Now, these effects were done with theatrical scrims. See, there you can really see the cloth. But those lightning effects behind the heads and everything, we had scrims with solid black shapes in them. And between them was basically a gauze. And we would shine a red light through it. And when you turned the light on, you saw the effect.
This set was built on a hill. There was a flight path for, because it's near the airport, it was a flight path. It was a landmark for pilots. And all of a sudden, they're seeing this old house on this familiar, and they were confused, you know?
Like, what the hell's going on? Where are we?
Yeah, but those opticals, you know, I mean, this was in the early days.
Yeah.
I mean, the optical of that meteor and everything, it really works. Now, Stephen King plays this role, and he still won't speak to me because I said, play it like the coyote in the Warner Brothers things. And he said, oh, people are going to hate it. And a lot of people did hate it, but I think it's perfect.
Well, he's a Huckabee. He's
a total rube. He's supposed to. I mean, you know, if this guy was played subtle, it wouldn't work.
When this meteor hit, I asked George what he wanted to see, and he said, how about a smoke ring? We tried to achieve it with a circle of explosions, but you get the wind...
You get a little bit of that effect when that's... But it's not, you know...
It would have been so cool, though, if a smoke ring just left the pit there, you know. Today, you would just
meteors.
CGI it in.
Well, I love how everything's tilted, and he just kind of...
CGI, he could do anything, right?
Could have erased the black cloth under Carrie Nye.
And there's Bingo O'Malley in one of his roles. Oh,
this... Yeah, Bingo was, when I interviewed him, he said his family didn't recognize him when they were at the premiere. It's just like, no, guys, that's me. Because he doesn't, I mean, I did it for the longest time. I knew it was the same actor playing, like, the doctor, but I didn't know it was the same guy playing the father at the very end that he sees. And I was just like, that was all Bingo. I was like, I couldn't believe that.
The father at the very end.
When Jordy sees Jordy's his father in the mirror.
Oh, yeah. In the
mirror,
that
was Bingo, too.
The disciplinarian.
That's the ticket.
Now, Bingo's a wonderful actor. I mean, he can really hide himself. But
this has been like a casting pool for me. I used Fritz. I used Bingo and House Call, and then Fritz and Tales from the Dark Side.
And so that's one of the effects you did—the little blisters
little plastic blisters. They eventually come up on his lip too, I think.
He's working those eyebrows, man. He's just going on
cool
thrills.
Doing, it's a cartoon. It's a cartoon. It's meant to be a cartoon.
Well, I have new meaning now in that, thinking that you asked him to be the coyote and the... You know, I can see...
Yeah, look, there's the thing where he does the clunk.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, Jordy.
I love the little rain cloud. It's like everything's gone to hell. Yeah.
Steve looking sad, knowing that he's screwed up.
Oh, Geordie.
I just love the fact that his idea of rich is $200.
Yeah.
To walk into a meeting and just say, $200.
Well, look where he lives.
Yeah, for him, that's enough to pay off a bank loan. It's enough to get him out of Hawkins. Everything's fine.
Well, it's funny. Steve writes from that perspective sometimes. Steve writes the common person, you know. And this is a pretty sad tale, actually.
Yeah, because he's not a bad guy. He's just...
And remember, we were trying to get this stuff to glow. And you know what we did? We had those things...
Siloom tubes.
Yeah, that you get at Disney World or wherever, and you crack them open and they glow.
Oh, yeah.
And...
Oh, that's glowing.
Well, I don't know if that's glowing or not.
Or if it's an effect.
Huh? It's glowing. It looks like you blocked out all the rest and just kind of concentrated.
Yeah, iris in on it.
Yeah.
But the stuff, the shot of the actual meteor where, because you had to see the hands and the meteor, that was hard to get that.
I bet.
We had to shoot way at the bottom of the lens, but the stuff was glowed enough to... On video today, you could shoot that, you know.
Oh, you could make that day glow green and bright.
Make it day glow whatever you want. But this was film. And this was the first time we actually had to buy stock footage.
That's what that is? Okay.
Huh?
Stock footage of the wrestlers?
A wrestling match, and later you'll see the footage of Star Wars, the original Star Wars Born.
So that's what that movie is there at the end. There's been some people have mistaken that movie for How Green Was My Valley, and I'm like, no, it's
not. Oh, no, it's Star Wars Born. Yeah. And these sets were, I mean, now, check it out. We wanted the stuff to be green, but the house to look blue. So the lighting was incredible in this.
Now, there's actually no green in the house anywhere, really. It's all very...
Well, so inside, it gets red. We were trying to accent it a little red when it gets alarming.
I've always loved this bit when he goes to the doctor. The camera's tilted and the doctor just rolls the frame. He just, like, where is he coming from?
And says, doctor's office. Hello. Well, you know, I mean, we just had this idea. Well, the frame is going to be tilted. The guy should be rolling downhill.
It's a great idea.
And I love the skeletons moving in the
front. He's going uphill.
Yeah. You've got everything low, and it's
almost as if he's surprised to have arrived.
So he's the roadrunner, and Steve's the coyote. This is going to be very painful.
Extremely painful, Mr. Barrow.
And getting that glint off the thing.
Oh, it's perfect.
It was all practical, man. I mean, we just sweated until the light was in the right place.
Yeah.
And Bingo had to turn that mirror right into the... position.
Yeah, Bingo mentioned that. He said he had to stay perfectly still just so that the light and the camera could focus
properly.
Yeah,
except he had to turn his head.
Right.
On that shot. And had to hit the mark.
Geordie Barrow, you lunkhead.
You know, just about everything that we effect special makeup effects-wise that we planned worked, except anything we tried on Stephen King. We had a tongue that grew plants that wouldn't work. We had a hand that grew plants, couldn't get that to work. We had green lenses to go in his eyeballs, plastic. His eyes were cast for that. Mm-hmm. Couldn't get him in, his reflexes were too tight, you know, his muscles.
But you do have at least a tongue, still have a little bit of growth on his tongue.
Oh, he sticks it out, yeah, that's right.
Yeah, there it is. Not that slow.
Well, see, that's not the fake tongue. We actually cast his tongue to make this stuff, and it wouldn't work.
Later.
I like how it looks like this stuff's just, the stuff's like pouring out of the faucet now.
All this green stuff is really there.
All the little details.
Now, this was all real set dressing by Cletus Anderson's crew.
Imagine from a continuity standpoint, that had to be a nightmare figuring out, okay, how much of it's up to the house by now? How much of it do we have here? And
well, they did it in stages, and we shot it in stages. So, you know, so stage one, stage two, stage three.
So you didn't have to worry about going back and forth too much?
No, we didn't.
You could choose whatever stage you wanted.
Because there's no, once he's in the house, he's in the house. There was no interactivity with any of it.
don't know if you can hear that, but there's a howling wind blowing up here on the 12th floor of this apartment building, right outside the windows
here. It's very appropriate, I think.
It actually worked really well with that little look that Steve gave.
The thing is, I mean, Steven's performance in this, yeah, it's very over the top, but you really feel for this guy. I mean, he's not...
You know what? It's over the top, but it's meant to be. I mean, how else are you going to do it? How else you do this? Try to do it realistically, and you...
Yeah, do it, underplay it. I mean, come on, you can't...
The guy is turning into
a plant. I mean, come on.
How serious do you... is it... what's the metaphor, you know?
Yeah.
Have we seen the ashtray yet?
We haven't been looking for the ashtray. No, we might have seen it.
Yeah, we might have, but I could have sworn it was.
He does go back to that chair,
yeah,
so
he does.
If it is sitting next to him.
We gotta look for the chair.
But it's probably all covered with green by now, you know?
When in doubt, booze.
Vodka.
Yeah.
And orange.
Make a screwdriver. Sad thing is, if I was in the situation, I'd probably be doing pretty much everything he does.
Same thing he does.
You know.
And this is actually Michael Gornick's brother.
Oh. Really?
Right? Who is a real priest.
Oh, so that wasn't, so you actually filmed that? For
we
this.
Actually shot that.
I thought it was a real sermonette. Remember they had those sermonettes?
Yeah, sermonette.
Oh, no,
that's Michael Gornick's brother.
Wow.
Who is a real priest.
I'm growing. He knows he's doomed.
Yeah. His luck is in and his luck is bad.
Yeah.
Do you have that outtake of him when the screen appears behind him
and
he coughs?
Yeah.
Which?
It's a behind the scenes stuff that I shot. On one take, when the screen appears behind him and he wakes up, he inhales, and I guess he inhales some plant and coughs it out on a take.
I think there you go.
Oh, what a...
Poor Jordy. Gotta feel sorry for the guy. There he goes. We got a little fog filter on this shot. Just to make it look a little fuzzier. And here comes Bingo again.
Clean shaven this time. It's the only one where he's not.
Okay, if you're turning into a plant, wouldn't the worst thing you could do is jump in a vat of water?
Yeah, but it itches.
Ah.
It's so itchy.
Jordy.
Eddie?
Jordy.
I did like the little line he had. Oh, no, not there.
Yeah. It's like...
Today they would cut to that shot and you'd see this.
You'd see it, yeah. I mean, why, you know, this? Why just talk about it when you can show it?
We resisted.
How are you?
And you got this. I was like, was it intentional? I mean, I don't know if you'd remember, George, but when you get the close-up of the water, you can actually see.
It's enticing.
Yeah, it's like, there's actually like little bits of the plant life on it almost. It's like almost like it's beckoning to him.
Well, we used, I think, a star filter or something to make it look...
just like the most amazing
like
thing.
Like a product shot of
right.
The,
yeah,
the
yeah.
water.
Daddy?
It beckons him.
Where'd my daddy go?
Well, he's going mad, isn't he?
At this point, it's all over.
His brain is turning to plant. There we are.
Yeah.
Bloop, bloop.
You can kind of tell that it's just something's wrong.
It's the universe out there. Gotta go for it. Boosh.
And that was it for him.
Yeah,
sealed
the end
his
of
fate.
The day. Fed them plants a little wanna.
What was the plant stuff made out of? Do you remember what it was?
I have no idea.
Yeah, it
says Barbary and Cletus.
Yeah.
Oh, you didn't stuff. Do that wardrobe?
No. I have very little to do on this episode. Because nothing worked. Everything we planned, nothing worked.
I thought you did the costume.
No, Barbara. Yeah. And even the makeup on
the greens, on the makeup.
Yeah, that was Barbara, too.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
But you do the effect that's coming up.
Yeah, yeah. In fact, I'm up in the ceiling now.
Oh, yeah?
I'm up in the ceiling with my finger on a button to make the blood bags in the top of the head explode, and I yank off the top of the head like a puppeteer from the ceiling. In fact, Daryl Ferrucci is in the costume, but he's lying flat. His body extends out through the wall of the set. Because he couldn't be there when we did that, you know, when this explodes. So when that happens, the sound effect was that. And you know what? Every time the gun went off, the costume caught fire. If you were to run that a little longer, somebody runs in and puts the costume
out. That's why we had to freeze it. We froze it.
Oh, because of the
we
costume.
We had to freeze the frame.
Oh, yeah.
You can see flame.
And Daryl never knew he was on fire because he can't see
anything. Yeah. He's just in there. Is everything okay?
No,
you're on fire, man.
And we, sorry. And we had to guide
him. Well, we're on top of it.
Yeah. We're going to lunch. See ya. It's been great.
And we had to guide his hands. No, left, down. Move it because he couldn't see where the gun was going, you know?
Here we are.
And now with that sign where it says Castle Rock was the beginning of Castle Rock.
That's when it started?
That's when it started. That became
Stephen King's
Rob Reiner's company.
And
it became the town where bad shit happens in a lot of Stephen King books.
All right, all right.
So we gotta remember seeing
that was the first time that Castle Rock ever showed up.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that. I thought it was around before that.
Nope.
Now, we gotta keep our eyes open for that elusive ashtray. We missed it in the last.
We missed it. We sure did miss it.
Yeah.
That may work on TV.
Please write in and tell us.
Yeah. I'll have to cover it in the documentary somewhere. Where the ashtray is in all the segments.
Well, you know what? For some of this is you need to see it large screen and really look for it. Because if it's here, if it's in this show, something to tide you over. It's in the apartment here somewhere, but you may not see it on a small
screen. So you didn't necessarily do a close-up of the ashtray in each episode. It was there. If you see it, you see it. Yeah.
Yeah. I think the only other time you really get a close-up of is in there creeping up on you when he's washing his hands, I think. But enough about the ashtray. We have two very interesting actors in this scene. We got Leslie Nielsen and Ted Danson.
Yeah.
And Leslie, of course, well-known today for being the funny man in Naked Gun movies and stuff, but you're playing an unbelievable bastard. And having a great old time doing it.
Oh, he's enjoying himself thoroughly, Leslie is, right here. What is mine? The old days of video, right, when it was...
Oh, no, look at the size of that deck. The thing's the size of a truck now. I mean, top loader and everything.
What did you mean?
And
who's Ted?
Ted. I mean, Ted was actually a really good guy, and he cooperated, 100% with this, and he did a really good job. But I don't know. I think that he was doing a horror movie. Everybody else, like Leslie and everybody else, all the other people in the cast were. Delighted, to be doing it. And just Leslie blew me away. I mean, I didn't know what to think of him. I saw him in Forbidden Planet. I knew that his early career, he was meant to be a charmer, a hunk, and all that. And then, but all of a sudden, I saw him as this wonderful actor. I mean, he's really a terrific actor.
And he's a tough guy. He's tough, and you believe it.
Yeah.
Aside from Forbidden Planet, he was in some of those Tales of Tomorrow episodes, black hair, young. Yeah. And he was a hero of mine in Forbidden Planet. In fact, I talked to him. The only phone was in our special effects lab, and he was always coming in and using it. I said, just please walk in whenever you want to.
So, George, where was this shot? Where was all the beef stuff shot at?
Now, we shot this in New Jersey. I think Ocean City or somewhere near there. Do you remember, Tom?
I wasn't there.
Tom wasn't there.
Yeah, I sent ahead.
Oh, for Ted Danson.
When you actually see the ocean coming and hitting the head, it's a fake. We just gave the prop guys a head. Take it with you to New Jersey. We were back and preparing some other episode, probably.
I wouldn't have thought that was. I mean,
now this was a little set right in front, the foreground piece. Mm-hmm. It was just a piece that we brought.
So that house was a matte painting.
Tie in the house, and this house is a matte painting. Wow. That house wasn't.
I never knew that.
Amazing. I thought you found a house and matched the interior.
No. Yeah. No, that was it. We painted that house in.
That's right. See,
excellent.
Just me thinking you know everything. You found out the house you always thought was a house was a freaking matte painting.
Isn't that the purpose of this? We're divulging
all the
secrets.
All the secrets. Yes.
The grand illusions. You know, we're diffusing all that.
And now we've got.
Leslie Briggs is. Look at he's so just.
He's giddy.
He's just incredible. He's just giddy. He knows exactly what he's gonna do to this guy.
And he's gonna torture him and kill him, and I'm gonna videotape it to play it back.
And taunt him with the fart machine after he's buried.
That's at the restaurant after we're finished shooting.
I walk on the set one day, first time I ever saw Leslie sitting over in the corner, surrounded by women over there, and I kept hearing these fart noises, you know. It's coming from him, oh no. Hollywood people.
You notice how the water creeps in?
Ted was, I saw Onion Field where Ted is plays a guy who is threatened at gunpoint and he freaks out and, you know, really gets nervous. And I said, boy, this guy's
interesting.
Perfect guy for this role.
Doesn't he get shot
in the Onion Field?
Yeah, doesn't he get shot in the face or something in the upper lip? Somebody does in that. Wasn't that James Woods as well?
Oh yeah, James Woods in the Onion Field.
James Woods, But Ted is so freaked in that, and I said, this is perfect. I mean, this guy's perfect for this.
Yeah, this guy's got to be in a continual state of panic for like the last...
Yeah, state of panic for a long time.
Yeah.
And...
Ted's got, he's got a difficult job because he's got to be panicked. He's got to be trying to reason a way out of this. And at the same time, he doesn't know really the full scope of what Richard's up to.
And he he doesn't know it yet, but he's soon to find out.
And Leslie, of course, cons him by saying, I just want you immobile.
Immobilized.
Meantime, I would never jump down.
No, that's another thing. It's just like, at that point, you know what? Shoot me.
No, but it's important that...
Yeah, but look at Ted. I mean, he's really good. He's great in this scene. And Leslie is just... Forget about it. I mean, he just knocks it out of the park. He's just so...
People forget how good he can be.
Oh, he's a wonderful actor.
The sad thing, though, is when they see this, they're going to associate him with Naked Gun and all the comedy stuff, you know.
But you know what? You don't get...
Contrast.
You don't get that sense when you watch this. It goes out of your mind really quick. He has the ability to just...
Well, he's physically different, too.
Yeah.
Here.
Yeah. Well, he's younger and...
Yeah.
Although the white hair, he still has the white hair, even back then.
Well, he's had white hair since he was 5.
Nobody's going to hear you, Harry.
That's not true.
Nobody's going to hear anything.
Yeah, that was important to have him shoot that. The gun, you know, that's...
So, you know, he will do it. Ted's just like...
Well, you know, all of a sudden you know that he's serious about it.
Well, how'd you do the bullet hole? Did you a slingshot or something? Or?
Yeah, I think it was a slingshot. It was something. They threw something at the sand and just...
And now he's neck deep in it.
Yeah. And, you know, obviously you can't do this to a person if you're making a movie. Yeah. So Ed Fountain designed these... little holes. I mean, he's actually sitting very comfortably on a chair, and there's a plate around him, around his neck, with a collar like
an iris
that, and we were able to put sand on it, make it look like he was buried. He's actually very comfortable. Now, when the water comes in, it
really
seeped down and it got very uncomfortable, but you couldn't do this. I mean, and we certainly couldn't rely on the real tides.
Well, no.
So Ed
just bury your actors out on the beach and see what happens.
See what happens.
Yeah. Well, the reality, if you buried someone that much,
that was ad lib.
They wouldn't be able to breathe. They wouldn't. They couldn't.
This little bucket, sort of an indicator. And we actually had a crab wrangler that brought this crab and said, well, you know, crabs, they don't do much. They're just crabs. But the crab actually opened its things.
Oh,
so you said action, and
the crab did.
No, I didn't. I didn't say anything. We were just rolling.
You got a performance out of the crab.
Yeah, look now. Look at that performance.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, okay. Maybe.
There's nothing there. Crab ain't doing nothing.
Like a cockroach.
Well, what is it they say? Never work with crabs and cockroaches.
Look at that. Oh, he's reared up because Leslie was approaching. Oh. And mean Leslie kicked them away.
Yeah, they wouldn't let you get away with it now. You have to kick a fake crab now. Yeah, he couldn't.
No crabs were harmed.
No crabs were harmed. Although except one was kicked.
And plenty of roaches were killed.
Take your mind off of it.
We didn't actually kill any roaches, but... And these, all this stuff, all these mats and all this, this effects work that we had to do, it was the first time we had ever done anything this complicated. I mean, this whole show was really complicated.
Well, so back then, was the screen on the television, did you have to make it a certain color to put that in later?
No, we didn't. Back then, who knew that you know, it wasn't green, it wasn't blue, it was just a TV.
No, that's a trick.
And they made the mat, they drew the mat, you know, by hand.
Wow.
I love this. Look back there. Oh, I'm sorry, you can't turn your head.
Yeah, yeah.
It's just...
Harry, the VCR is not on play, it's on record. I'm going to save this stuff.
And that really does capture the point of these stories, that the villains of these things are just nasty people.
Nasty people who are bound to get punished, right?
Yeah.
I mean, you've got to punish these guys.
They earn
if you were just like walking into this room and saw that two shot of Leslie lying there and Ted sticking out of the set, what the hell is going on here?
Yeah, exactly.
Like that, what, you know?
Well, you'd probably say, isn't that Leslie Nielsen? Wait a minute, isn't that Ted Danson?
Whoa, what are they doing? Is this a comedy?
Why is he buried in the sand?
Holding your breath and ready for that wave is covering.
And we have Galen Ross there.
That's Galen Ross from Dawn of the Dead. Good old friend.
The next wave comes in.
Was willing to let herself get soaked here. And that's Ed Fountain's wave machine, because he couldn't put them under there and subject them to the real tides.
Right.
So you had to have something that shot water at them.
Was it like a big trough?
Increasing, it was basically like a big shovel. That,
So they would fill that with water from the sea and then let it go.
And different levels, you know, you could get it. A little bit of wave hits you, a lot of wave hits you, and you're engulfed.
Oh, the tide.
It's coming in.
Oh, the tide.
I've always loved John Harrison's music for this particular moment, because it's just like this tragic moment where it's like, this is it. The fates have been sealed, and this guy is completely screwed, and it's operatic, and it's...
Well, I had a Moviola flatbed brought to my apartment at the time. These poor two guys had to schlep this thing all the way upstairs into my apartment. And I was editing this, and I said, John, I called John, actually, right when I got to this point. I said, could you compose a piece of music which would be on a metronome? I mean, that would be boom, 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 boom. And then I said, could you lay a tune over it, like the tune he's whistling, Camptown Races? And so John did. He did this thing, boom, boom. And I said, I got these cuts. I'll do these cuts. They're going to be, you know,
all the stuff in this house.
14 frames apart, each cut. And John came up with this piece of music, boom, 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 boom. And he laid the Camptown Races over it. And it was amazing. And it was like, look at that. Now, that was a dummy head. That was the head, I think, that you sent.
That's
the head.
Yeah, because it's too close to the ocean.
And then, of course, there's the big water tank that the last shot we see of Ted, where he's literally underwater.
Yeah.
I always thought that must have been a scary thing you tried to shoot.
Well, go ahead.
A scuba guy that could lower a regulator into his mouth whenever he gave a certain symbol. Plus, I think he could stand up whenever he wanted to, just in case. But I had a sledgehammer that I hid, just in case something went wrong.
Right.
I would have broken it like Houdini, and the water would have just gushed out, you know? Just in case, you know?
He was actually in a tank of water. I mean, it was a tank of water, and we lit it, and we put the scrims behind it, you know, to get that effect. And but he was in, he was
so fully submerged.
Yeah, he was fully submerged.
With the sand and the weeds and everything, you'll see that coming up. This is the set that was built inside the high school gym, the interior of his house. I lived on that set. Instead of going home at night, I would do the couch because there was a big shower room there because it was a high school gym. Mm-hmm. Wake up, shower, and go to work.
Pretty nice place, actually.
Oh, I loved it.
There was, where'd you sleep?
On that couch.
On Leslie's, on that couch?
On that couch.
We've lit it perfectly, Bat, that you'd never guess in a million years that was a set.
Yeah. Just now, this painting that's above these monitors, you have that.
Yeah.
And Bamba has the Buddha.
The Buddha that's in his bedroom. Yeah. But speaking of paintings, just there's a painting of the actor who plays the father in Father's Day.
Oh, John Larmer?
Yeah. Do you know where that painting?
No, I don't know that. But Cletus did the painting here. Yeah. Huge painting.
Well, didn't he also do John Larmer?
Oh, there's your head again.
Yeah, I think he did. But he did it at the last minute. We needed something in a frame to slide up over the screens and uncover the screens.
Oh, my God.
And Cletus did that at the last minute. He wrapped it together. I mean, he was putting the last strokes on it when we were hanging it. He Cletus was really. Whoa!
It's the one moment he almost feels bad about it in the entire episode. That's the
you
only.
You think he feels bad
at that point?
No, I don't think.
Well, he's hearing the screams, and it's just the one moment he kind of looks away, and then right
the
after that,
the fun's over.
Yeah, he's killing them now.
It's over now. Yeah. His whole reason for
doing everything
existing, you know. Right. Now what does he do? Now here's that's go. Ted in the tank.
Light comes up from behind him, and at any moment you were ready to smash him out of there.
Yeah, but boy, this was it was actually pretty scary. I mean, we had people with regulators, divers that had regulators that were ready to stick one in his mouth.
Yeah,
Well, it doesn't take long for something to go wrong.
That's the same water tank that the miniature crate was dumped into on the set like it was going in the quarry. And also where the remains of Adrian popped up later on.
All right.
You know, that was actually really hard to bury that TV in the sand and make it look undisturbed. Like it had actually.
I'll bet. Also, the bucket plays a part here, too. The bucket being buried shows you
that it's
what happened to the people.
Out.
Yeah,
right. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, like right there.
Tide pulled them out.
Windy day. Look at them pants flapping.
It's funny how little details
we went. We were only down there for, I think, 2 or 3 days or whatever.
Really? That's it? It was only a couple days?
In Jersey, yeah, because all the sets were in Pittsburgh.
Right.
But, you know, we went to we went out one evening to a restaurant with Leslie, and of course everybody recognized him, and, you know, but... When people would come up and say hello, and he'd blow off his fart machine. Hello.
And, he had it on the Letterman show once.
Oh, yeah?
He was a guest. To get a rise out of Letterman, you know.
Right.
He farted?
Yeah, he had the machine. He eventually pulled it out and showed him what
well,
it was.
Well, yeah, I would hope so. Otherwise, you know.
Because Letterman was like a little embarrassed.
I've never seen what it was. I mean, it's just I couldn't imagine how this thing could be so.
Oh, I have one.
Have such high fidelity.
I have
and
one.
And keep it in your pocket, hidden in your hand.
It's a little cylinder with a hole at the end, and you squeeze it, and it forces the air into your palm,
right.
Which does the blap. You know.
You have one?
Yeah. You can get them in novelty stores.
I was wondering.
I know the scene in, what's the one he did with Priscilla Presley?
Oh, when they're walking out of the movie theater.
They're walking out of a platoon.
Right.
And laughing. I know that he cracked her up
with the
and himself up. In fact, later on, the scene where he does crack up in front of the thing behind him, the comic book thing, yeah. I'm sure he's doing that just to crack the crew up and himself, you know.
Now, I always thought it was, I always read it, of course, I saw this movie when I was a kid, but when he's looking through all his videotapes, all the tapes he's labeled, that's his private collection of all the horrible shit he's done to people. That's how I always read it. You know, because I mean, you can't believe he's had this set up before. He's too good at this. So imagine how many wives has he had that he's gotten rid of over the years.
Only the ones that
pissed him off.
Yeah, I'll just say that. Can we say piss him off?
Yeah.
Okay.
Shadows, look out.
Oh, wait, this is for the British people, so he's a wanker.
He's a But maybe someday the Americans will hear this and be like, a wanker?
What's a wanker?
What's Tom talking about?
Get that word into the vocabulary. It's a good word.
Yeah, wanker. You wanker. There's the Buddha.
There's the Buddha.
There's the Buddha.
I filmed Bamba's interview in front of the Buddha, the Buddha is
interesting.
Behind.
People must have just walked away with stuff. I have all the bookcases in Hal Holbrook's study in my bedroom.
Dave Burian has one of the crates.
Who?
Dave Burian, friend of mine in Pittsburgh. Yes.
Oh, he has E.G. Marshall. He has the crate. He just buys stuff left and right.
We had these critters in a fish tank. The fish tank was real. There in the
shooting field.
On the set.
Oh, they would put me to sleep. I'd be on the couch just staring at those fish.
At the fish and just at
them. Now, when Ted and Galen come in, they backstage in the special effects lab, in their makeup, they were going through the lines, but they were doing it as hillbillies. We begged them to please do one take in front of George and the camera the way you're doing, and they didn't do it. But it was
You have a little bit of it on your behind the scenes stuff.
Do I?
Yeah, because they're just sitting there going, "We won't see you, Richard." Yep, that's right. Come on to the beach, Richard. They're just.
Is that right?
Yeah,
didn't know any of this.
They were hilarious backstage, you know.
All right, Richard, we just want you to come down to the beach.
Imagine if they walked in doing that.
Oh, that would have been hilarious.
The water turned them into Southern Hicks or something. Now this is all a set. The jacuzzi worked. The
everything
worked. Yeah,
everything worked, man. I mean, Cletus went to great lengths to get this stuff for real. I mean, there was real water in that shower.
Here they come.
His video will not help him since they can't be seen on video.
There's the ashtray.
There's the ashtray.
Ta-da.
So we've at least identified it twice.
Two out of five.
Well, yeah.
Two out of three.
Yes,
we got to go back to
Geordie. We missed it in
Geordie
Vero.
See where it is. Yeah. It may have been cut out, I'm telling you.
But it wasn't cut out. We got a good shot of it here, so.
I suggest we had to make a cast of his gun right there to make a rubber gun, so when he throws it, it bounces off one of their heads, you know.
My breath! I'll shoot you dead!
All these raked angles and, you know, comic booky kind of things.
Yeah, everything's tilted and slightly askew, and
yeah,
it feels like it just jumps right off the page.
It's a comic book.
It is a comic book,
man. I mean, that's what we were trying to do.
Thank God.
Light subtle change in the light. Aquamarine.
Did you do stuff to the voice to mark it?
Yeah, we messed up the voice to make them
waterlogged.
Sound. Yeah, watery.
So, Tom, how was that makeup accomplished there? You just kind of...
It was built up on their life cast. It wasn't a piece, you know, like a prosthetic piece. It was built up with tissue paper and just to get that wrinkly, watery...
Right.
I think, realistically, they would have been bigger, bloated more.
Sure.
Know? But just to get that... You know how your fingers get if you're in water too long?
Right.
You know, that's what I was looking for, trying to create on their faces. We did their leg. We did her legs and their hands and his face, of course.
Yeah. You did her legs?
Oh, yeah.
You never see them?
No, I know. It was fun doing her legs, though, because I did it all the way up to her.
Oh my God, poor Galen.
Now, right here was supposed to be when he would slam the door on Danson's hand, in the,
right.
And Rick did the animation. And he was supposed to, the hand grabs his leg, he kicks it into the tub, you know, and that's how he gets rid of it. That's great. Look at that.
Well, Leslie Nielsen's just selling it for all it's worth, man.
Oh, man, he's just fabulous. He goes right into laughter.
Oh, he's gone around
the
back.
It's like the guy in The Mummy who just laughs hysterically when he sees something scary. Right. You know?
Well, that shot holds
up. Here, he's got to be hitting the fart machine here. You know, he's just cracking himself up, you know?
No, he was just...
just doing it.
Acting.
Just doing it. We should get him on Inside the Actors Studios.
Oh, yeah.
Hold my breath for a long time. Ba-da-bing. And all these ins and outs to the drawings couldn't be done until we had shot the film. So that was a complication. Because the effects people were waiting for our footage before they could do a match into it.
Do you know this guy's name?
Don Kiefer.
See, since working with him on this movie, I see him as a young guy.
Oh,
Twilight Zones,
all
and
over
so
the place.
Much stuff.
This guy, Don Kiefer, has been around forever. He's another, like John Larmer guy. Maybe more. Maybe he has done more roles. And
character.
He's still around. Don Kiefer's.
Really?
Yeah, he's still around. He was in Liar Liar, I believe, with Jim Carrey not too long ago. But you see him in, you see him in lots of stuff.
Yeah. The crate.
The crate.
A crate full of Fluffy.
How much time did we spend in this little crawl space down there? Dexter, you
are such Fritz.
A my man Fritz. My man Hal.
Just point the camera and say action.
Henry has made a
choice. Adrian. Just great.
Cletus. There's Cletus Anderson right there.
Oh, yeah, there he is.
That's him right there on the left.
Tabby and Richard Raymond. They're new with us in the math department.
How do you do? What a lovely name you have.
Actually, it's Tabitha.
Chris Howe is best known for Mark Twain.
Just thinking what a thrill it was to just see Hal Holbrook. I had watched him as a kid on the Brighter Day soap opera. And then Mark Twain just blew me away, of course.
He was playing the most henpecked husband of all time. He's just retreated so much back and just being this, shallow little guy, and all of a sudden he gets an opportunity to do something about it.
Take my word for it.
It's cooking. He's cooking.
Oh man, you see it. I tell you what, I never could appreciate everything that Hal was doing more than any other actor I've ever worked with. I'd be there on the set and I'd say, he didn't do so much.
He's doing so little.
And then we saw the dailies and he was fabulous. I mean, he was perfect.
It's all these little expressions and little glances that he gives. Just like, oh God, kill me now.
I mean, look at that, like that shot. I mean, there's so much there.
If Dex Stanley hadn't had his teeth capped, he'd have been out on his ass years ago.
I think this is the first time I've ever heard the C word.
Well, it's not in the R. That's the funny thing about that when she says that.
Just have your ashes.
That whoever that etiquette cunt is, that's the line. But in the version that was released, it was dubbed over to say crotch.
Whoever that is.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I heard.
That's how it is. Although in the work print that's been circulating for years, says cunt.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oddly enough. Maybe people in 82 just weren't ready for the C word. I don't know.
Well, Steve has always been the one to, break those barriers or to, so he doesn't give a shit, I think, about anything conventional, which is fine with me.
And right.
I had no problem going with it.
Right.
Everything else. But I didn't realize they had cut it out anyway.
You sure that wasn't just for the TV version?
Yeah. No, that's always been the one. Mm. Remember, it's always been that way.
Look at these guys are just so, they're so subtle, you know. They're perfect.
They're the pros from Dover.
Yeah.
And then Tom, yeah, you and he, Fritz had a very memorable role in the Tales from the Dark Side that you did inside the closet.
Oh,
a couple years after this.
Just call me Billy. Everyone does.
And it is very well edited. I mean, Paul Hirsch edited this, and you know, we were all intimidated by Paul because
he was the Star
Oscar
Wars guy, wasn't he?
Star Wars, yeah. And but you know, when you look at this, it's really very, very well edited.
Yeah, he's very dedicated. Look,
the wind's really kicking up outside now. It's just like,
too bad you can't hear that.
It's perfect.
What I just love about this episode is the implications. It's like, so if Fluffy's been sitting in there all this time,
it's over 100 years.
Yeah. What's he been doing? You know,
hanging out,
hibernating.
Yeah. And I always understood, why does Hal Holbrook think drowning him is going to solve the problem?
It doesn't. He breaks out.
Yeah, exactly. It's just like, guys, you know, creature's been sitting in there with no air, no food, no nothing for 100 years. I don't think a little water is going to harm him that much. But at the end of the day, you know.
Well, I asked Rick Catazone and Phil Wilson to come up with some sketches of what, because the script said we see a blur of fur and some teeth. That was it, a blur of fur and some teeth. Oh, this is good. This is now here. There's an appliance on her head.
Not a thing, Will.
An explosive on the back of her head. And Daryl Ferrucci was operating the blood. So I said to him, don't pump that blood until I tell you. Mm-hmm. I never told him. So no blood gushed out of that hole. Because, you know, I was concentrating on the air, blowing the hole out of her forehead, sinking it with the explosion on the back of her head. So.
What was that?
But you do get a zets coming out of the back.
Yeah.
Of her head.
Oh, you see it. Yeah, for sure.
Huh?
Oops. Back to reality.
Huh. That's just what I didn't
He just looks so disappointed.
Just wishes he could have done it.
Yeah. He just blew her brains out in his mind, you know, so.
But it's a perfect setup, right, for what he wants to do to her. And there's another one later where he tries to strangle her.
Without me to take care of you.
This part is so unlike Adrienne in real life. I mean, it's such a completely different persona. It was always, and I had never seen her do anything like that, that hinted that she could go so completely over the top like this. I mean, she was amazing in this part.
Well, in life, Adrienne's such a sweetie pie, and here she plays such a shrew that it's, if you know her,
She still looks the same, too, conventions. Right. She had twins at the age of 50, I think.
53.
Yeah, 53. Wow. The crate. I just traded that crate to Greg Nicotero for Gort, the robot.
No, you're kidding.
Vader's system. I have Gorts in my bedroom now.
You have Gort in your bedroom?
Full-size Gort. I just had to have it.
Which I don't know how you got up there.
How high is your ceiling?
It's like, Gort's like 8'5", and the ceiling is 9.
Oh,
his head is on. Just made it.
How'd you get him in?
Oh, it was tough. But he had to be in my bedroom, one way or another.
But every time I see you at a show, it seems like you're always buying some 6'5" statue.
I just bought a full-size Terminator robot last weekend.
And I'm like,
Monster Mania.
Yeah,
and that's in my gym now.
Right, yeah. And you bought a Gilman out of last year.
That's in the backyard, covered in snow. Oh, but I was talking about Fluffy now. So I asked Rick Catazone and Phil Wilson to come up with some sketches on what they think Fluffy should look like. And then I did some sketches, and we presented them to George and Stephen King. And they chose one of my sketches, and that's why Fluffy looks the way he does. Although, in retrospect, I think he should be skeletal, you know, because he's not eaten in so many. Right. But it's a comic book, so, you know.
Yeah, if you're gonna worry about how could he possibly survive in there and let that ruin your enjoyment.
Well, it's not about food, is it?
Well, we did give him a huge mouth. If he's going to be eating people, he needs to have this huge kind of mouth.
Yeah, wrap it around something.
And I had no idea how to build a Fluffy, an articulated creature like this. So I called Rob Bottin, who had done Howling. But Tanya's Island was this big gorilla creature that he constructed. So over the phone for an hour and a half, he explained step by step on how to build an articulated creature. Meantime, before this, we all went to LA for the premiere of Knight Riders. And I went to Rob's house and saw the mechanisms for the howling John Carradine's head. And that was that's when I learned how to build one before we built them.
Did you feel it when
this is the first articulated creature I ever made?
Stairs.
How pretty heavy.
It's a great creature. I mean, unfortunately, you don't see too much of his capabilities.
Well, you know, I mentioned that you were sad. You came to me in your office and said, you know what, the guy who edited this thing did not show a lot of fluffy. And I was pleased because my feeling is when you see the whole monster in a movie, oh, that's it? Okay, I can deal with that. You're not afraid of it anymore, you know? Getting bits and pieces of it, like Alien and like what you see of fluffy, I think helps. It's almost like the jaw, a shark not working in Jaws.
Right. What a blessing in disguise that turned out to be.
Yeah.
Scrub him or put him away.
Because we don't really get to see much of Fluffy. There's only a couple really full shots of him, and then that's it.
And they're quick, which is good.
They're quick. There's only a couple.
So you're left with the impression.
But you really don't. Well, when you see the shark in Jaws, first of all, it looks rubber when it comes up and bites.
Robert Shaw. Yeah.
You know.
Makes me want to rout.
Yeah, that's why he was wise to keep it off as much as possible.
And it's like when you see the alien in the end of Alien, it's a guy in a suit, right?
Finally, but it only at the very end.
At the very end,
when they blast him with the rocket,
blown out of the tube,
right?
Whatever. But it destroys the image somehow. Yeah. I mean, it really does. Sort of go what?
Oh, it's but with Fluffy, you never get enough. You never get enough to really go. Yeah. Wait a minute, what's this?
And you know, in Alien, it's even hard to justify how that suit makes sense with what you saw earlier.
Doesn't match what you've been seeing.
It doesn't anatomically make sense with what you saw.
Because you had to try to imagine what he looked like. You only saw a tail,
teeth.
You know, teeth coming out.
So your mind constructs this weird thing, and then you see a guy in a suit, and you're like, wait, what? Huh?
Yeah. But in here, the threat is there.
Right.
From the moment he kills this janitor guy.
The threat. We don't see him. We don't see anything here except some eyes.
Well, blood gushing out of
him. And blood. But we don't see anything of the creature.
Right.
But we know.
I mean, this stuff, I think, really works well.
Well, the setup's great because we know something's in there. Something bad's about to happen. We just can't conceive of.
Right.
And once again, it's Dal Ferrucci, plant guy from Jordy Verrill. He's going to be there all the time. Let him be the creature. You know, he's going to be there. We actually cast his body, and Barbara Anderson had one of her students build his body out of the foam. And, of course, we painted it and put the hair on it, you know. And we had to send him to New York to have his eyeballs cast for these special hard lenses he wears as Fluffy. You'll see an eyeball pretty soon in here, both of his eyes. And they were hard to keep upright. They were cat eyes, you know. They kept, most of the time we were doing is keeping his eyes up, you know, on camera.
Christ, I can't see a friggin' thing.
So the inference is that you kind of assume he is the Tasmanian devil.
Yeah.
At the end of the day.
I mean, he's something beyond our ken. Doesn't matter.
That needs chains around the box.
Right.
I was
okay, here it comes, I think. There's a quick shot of... it's cool. It's their eyes and then...
His eyes.
Looking Fluffy's back. Eyes. There you go. Oh. Microsecond.
And red lights and...
What the hell was that?
You just hear the crunching and the ugh. I mean, the sound mix the sound effects used in this movie were wonderful because it helps infer more than you're seeing anyway.
I know, but can you really do this? I mean, could this really happen to a guy? Can you actually get dragged? It's like in Steve's story, The Raft. Can you pull a guy through a 1-inch crack and have nothing left but his wedding ring? I mean,
I don't know if you can, but it sure is fun to see it happen.
Carpenter pulled a whole woman through a window pane.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, but this guy, the janitor just gets literally just, there he is.
Hey!
First glimpse. You see him drool?
You see him drool and you see a big bunch of teeth. And that's, that sells it right
now,
there.
Those teeth will cut you. the teeth in the real fluffy head like that. There were two fluffies. Mm-hmm. That one was the real fluffy with really sharp teeth. We built a puppet for biting, like when he bites Adrian and the student, and they were rubber teeth.
He just gets swallowed
up.
No,
I still have the puppet.
Oh, yeah.
We could have shot some footage of that damn thing, but it was in storage and buried now. And
now this is a real hallway out at
Carnegie Mellon
this
University.
Carnegie Mellon.
That's Robert Harper as Charlie Garrison.
See him a lot too.
Oh, he's been in tons of stuff, Law and Orders, all that stuff. He pops up a lot.
Robert Harper, really good actor. I mean, he sells this 100%. You just completely. I mean, you know, it's the whole thing. To keep a straight face, even though the stuff is outrageous and silly and ridiculous, the whole idea is to keep a straight face through it.
And well, you have to commit to it. Otherwise, if you're winking at the audience, it doesn't work.
They are playing it serious and straight.
Yeah.
Not
yeah.
like comic book or
oh,
not,
yeah,
you
no,
know, Stephen
exactly.
King, but
they're in it for 100%.
You know, something's going on down there. They should have called the cops immediately. You know, the janitor was just eaten by something in a box. You know.
Yeah, but who? There was nobody there except.
And how do you call the cops? It's like, oh, there was this thing in a box and it ate my janitor. I mean, you know, his instincts.
Right.
Were...
There's a blob. There's a blob
yeah,
eating
exactly.
people on the street. Yeah.
Well, I mean, Fritz might have been running to call the cops, but he ran into
Robert. Got distracted. Yeah. And Fritz is so completely gone at this point.
He's Fritzed.
Well, they had to do it this way, or Hal would not have a way out of Adrian.
Right, right. Yeah, exactly.
You know?
I think you'd been off on a hell of a toot. No.
And they convinced us, let's go check it out. No problem over here.
Yeah, this guy's just too curious.
Yeah, he just wants to see, oh man, what did this
I'm
crazy
go
guy
see
do?
How the land lay.
Yeah. He gets down there.
Well, oh. Fritz is on the verge of a nervous breakdown. Oh, his reaction when he goes after this, when he goes to Hellhole, it's just priceless.
Who, Fritz?
Fritz, yeah, he can't talk and he just starts laughing.
He
you know?
Just starts laughing. No, he's wonderful. He's Fritz's. Great. And this stuff too, when I forget the name of the character, but when he gets first, now he's realizing, oops.
Crazy now.
The old fake old shock there, hand on the shoulder, and give me a break.
Do all horror movies have to have the hand on the shoulder?
Got to.
Yes.
Got to. Otherwise, you know.
Well, there's good ways to do it.
What do they call that? When the cat jumps through a window? And
fake scare?
Huh? Yeah. It's a fake scare, yeah, but is there a name for that? Or
I don't know.
Chair jumper?
I don't know. I don't know if they've named that particular type of scare.
But, I mean, Fritz is, the actors are so wonderful in this, and that's exactly
brilliant.
What sells it, you know, completely. They're just completely into it.
Oh, they believe it, and you wouldn't
believe it.
Then,
I mean, they're just absolutely there. Now, this thing, when this guy goes in there, and of course, we're not tipping anything ahead of time by saying he's going to get his ass.
But, say that again, please.
He's going to get his ass.
He's going to get his ass. Okay.
But remember, we did. What was that? I said build a big bronze claw.
Oh, we did. Yeah.
Yeah, you did.
George, I can't raise this thumb any higher than that.
Because
of the bronze claw.
Oh.
That thing weighed 50 pounds, and I had a handle on it. And it was for scenes where the claw would miss and take a chunk out of the wall or scratch or something. So swinging that around, I severed, it's called the extensor pollicis longus tendon. That's how I know, because the doctor, you know, and that's it. I can't raise that thumb any higher because of Fluffy's bronze claw.
And we built this thing so that you could take a swat with a claw, mm-hmm. and it would be heavy enough to actually destroy shit.
Take a chunk
out of a wall.
Crash the plaster, you know?
And I'm sorry, I didn't know that story.
Yeah, this is it. I lost the use of that thumb, which, of course, George, screws up my mime and my sleight of hand. Look, there it is.
Coin tricks.
There it is, you know? That was the end of my magic career.
Oh, man.
But for the art, you know.
Yeah, sure. But what I'm trying to think is
where did we use it?
Where did we use it?
I don't know.
Is it actually in the movie?
Okay, here comes the claw.
There's the claw.
There's
something
teeth.
Where. This is the widest shot you see of.
And it was in that scene that he does crawl toward
crawl,
you
yeah.
on the magic floor. But and it was my arm cutting him, but Daryl attacks him in the suit.
I was so disturbing. He just like just rips the back of his head right off.
And now there's like three guys under there with Fluffy to pull the actor out. Because Daryl couldn't possibly do it on his knees and all that, so there's like zip.
Zets, that's the end of him. That's the name of that tune. And this scene, this was the first time that I you know, I'm looking at Hal Holbrook and he's like, you know, this is a wonderful actor. And I said, you know, tame it down a little bit. And right here, what the hell happened to you? Or whatever he says right there. I said, just...
What the hell happened?
People like that, huh?
And, you know, it was amazing. I mean, I actually... Here's me. This is my first time working with real, you know, honest to God pros. And mm-hmm. I gave an instruction or a direction.
Uh-huh.
And the guy took it. And he said, you know, that was a good idea.
That had to make you feel good.
Gave me confidence, you know, forever and ever. And this is the scene you're talking
about. Yeah, yeah, look.
It's just hysterical.
He just goes...
Because it's unbelievable, you know, what he's talking about.
He's like, how do I explain this exactly? It couldn't possibly have happened.
But the change in his voice when he goes from the hysteria to the serious, you know, it's amazing.
I guess he got his chance.
He's just, these guys were fabulous. They were just great.
We had to believe these guys.
We were so lucky to get them. I mean, they just are, you know, 100%.
And now the wheels are beginning to turn for Hal Holbrook.
The only hint is, I think, when he slips him a Mickey.
He's getting it now.
Yeah, like, more than a hint.
Yeah.
He's getting it right there in that shot. You know he's not worried about
right
his
there.
Buddy.
Yeah.
He's thinking about, what can I make out of this?
What can I do?
How can I profit from this?
What can I do?
I mean, you just...
But he's got to trust this guy. He's got to trust Fritz now.
Yeah.
You know, his good chess buddy here. He's got to...
Yeah, he's got to knock him out for the time being, but he's got to trust he's going to go along.
Because
what
he's going to do afterwards is going to have to be explained to...
So you have these bookshelves, Tom? Is that what you said?
Yes, all the bookcases in his room there in my bedroom.
What are friends
for? What are friends for?
And he's just like, I'm going to get to kill her.
This story was previously published by Steve as a short story. So it was, I guess, a little easier for him to write this screenplay.
Was this the only one of the five that was previously published?
No, I think, I don't remember. I think one of the others. Maybe Geordie was pre-published. I don't know. I'm not a historian. You have to research this. But there he goes. All these shots. Mike got all his stuff. Man, we used to make 1,000
ashtray.
Shots.
The ashtray was right there next to the note he was writing.
Yeah, but we've seen it in this story.
Right? Not in this one. This is the first time we'd seen it in this story.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. So we've seen it now in Father's Day, Something to Tide You Over, and Decree. We missed it in Geordie Romero.
So that's three.
Three out of four.
Yeah. That's a pretty good batting average. That's not bad.
It's pretty good. We got to find it in Geordie, and it may not be there. It may either have been cut out, probably cut out, because I know that we had it there, but somewhere, but I don't know where. Maybe it has green all over it.
Where is it as a soap dish?
In They're Creeping Up on You.
Oh, okay.
I mean, Hal plays this so straight. I mean, there's no other way to do it, right?
I mean, if you
in something this arch, what are you gonna, you know, what do you do except play it completely straight?
If you're playing it to the camera or winking at it, the audience isn't going to buy any of this.
Yeah,
they're not going to buy into the dramatics of it at all.
It's like you can't play funny. It's either funny or
yeah.
And you know what? The greatest jump, the greatest scare that I've ever in any of my films. Was this thing when he knocks a mop and it clacks against the wall? And it was the biggest jump that I've ever gotten. It was a silly little thing. And I told the sound guys, just make that thing when it hits the wall a little louder.
Yeah.
And tink, boy, in the silence. It,
yeah, because there's no other sound at all at that
point.
There's
no other sound. It makes the whole audience goes blink off their chairs 6 inches. Biggest jump that
is a mop
in any of my film.
Well, because the suspense exists already, you know. That
yeah, you don't know where Fluffy is. Is he back?
And then when he puts the lock on.
Oh, that one's a killer. Yeah.
Well, it's a very suspenseful scene to begin with. I mean, I think it works that way, first of all. But, you know, you never. It's amazing how, you know, you can little say, well, I'll have this guy jump out of a closet or I'll do this and right. Bada boom, bada bing and make it as startling as possible. And it's never as startling as you expect it to be. And this little moment with him knocking over the mop was the biggest jump ever.
Well, it's all in how you have the audience at that point. If they're just waiting for something,
yeah.
You can do anything to them at that point.
God damn it!
And this sequence was, it was tough because it was hard to keep track. I didn't know we were going to completely intercut this so freely.
Oh, yeah.
And so I was trying to shoot each sequence as if it was its own sequence.
Right.
And then later we decided, well, we should just intercut it and make it sort of simultaneous action.
Well, it's great because we're seeing how he's racing
what
against
he's
time.
Doing, right, exactly. And what's happening to her.
Is he going to get it all cleaned up before she shows
yeah.
up?
Yeah.
But it was a last-minute decision to intercut it.
Ever since Dexter's wife.
And I think it works much, much better. And John's music.
Oh, it's perfect. That da-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na. It's just like, it's like, is he going to finish? Is he? I mean, it's just, he just keeps bringing it because it's wonderful. All mixes together so well.
Sure. It says something about her that she mixes alcohol and milk.
Milk. Hey, come on. Scotch and milk. It's good for the stomach.
So it's the drink and the antidote at the same time.
It's the most innocuous drink, and it's like infusing it with a shot of booze.
Yeah. I tried.
And Adrienne was just so game. I mean, she did this, you know, like she was glamour queen, and she just let herself be a total bitch here and just, you know, went balls out for it. She was great.
Because you hate her. You hate everything about her. I mean, you just can't stand her.
Well, you want Fluffy to chomp on her.
Yeah, but I don't necessarily hate everything about her. She still looks pretty good.
Well, that.
If only she weren't such a bitch. Yeah.
Exactly.
If only she's a hot chick. If only she weren't. But the pretty ones are all crazy.
But as you so often say, what would I do without you?
What indeed, Henry? What indeed?
Oh boy, what fun this was, Tom.
Oh,
I mean, this whole thing was. Well, you know, we had a lot of fun and a lot of moments.
There were so many highlights that to look forward to and to achieve, and then to achieve it, there was happiness.
And it was the innocence. We weren't yet swallowed by the studio system and by all the garbage. And, you know, we were having a good time over there, thinking that we were, you know.
I mean, it was never a job. It was just
like,
fun.
Hey.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, we get to build a creature. We get to kill people. Turn Stephen King into a plant, the cockroaches. I mean, you know, who you don't do this every day.
No.
You know?
That's the big secret, you know, with all of us back in those days. When in the early days, all through from Night of Living Dead through this, through Knight Riders, through all the way until, you know, sort of like.
like around Day and Monkey Shines, I guess.
Yeah, Monkey Shines. Mm-hmm. Monkey Shines was the first one, and even Monkey Shines I had a pretty good time on, but it was a studio picture, and it brought with it, you know, those studio woes, you know. And before that, we were just, you know, we were free range, man. free range chickens. Doing whatever the hell we want.
It's a good company name.
Free range. Free range.
No, free range chickens.
Free range chickens.
Yeah.
No, we ain't chickens, though.
Can I use that?
Yeah. You can use that.
You can use that. Okay, yeah, we
want to sign something.
Yeah. Instead of Tom City Limited, free range
chickens incorporated.
Mark, what the hell does that mean?
Listen to the creep.
They have to listen to this to
they
find
have to
out.
Figure out what the hell you're talking about.
He does this. This moment, he does this so that. I mean, just so.
He's just so nervous.
Perfectly.
He's so
and
nervous.
And then he can't stop from laughing. I mean,
it's absurd.
How perfect is this performance? It's like he just can't keep himself together.
Well, he can put up with any abuse at this moment because he knows.
I know, but it's
check it going out. To
right here, right here.
Is he conscious?
Look at this. He's sucking it up and he can't resist a little chuckle.
He's gonna turn away so she doesn't see the laugh.
Yeah, because even he can't hold it together at this point. It's like, what am I doing? This is so absurd.
But he has to make up a story too now.
Right, because he can't possibly back
what's
out
so
now.
Funny? Well,
but you don't understand. Any one of you try to stand there and do that and pull that off.
I mean,
so subtly.
Oh,
it's just like.
Because he's having to act like four emotions at once.
You're talking about Hal Holbrook.
Yeah, I know. But
who does Mark Twain imitating a slave who is imitating a kid? He did all the voices, you know.
Still.
It's a remarkable feat.
He's just brilliant.
He has to be nervous, anxious, and hysterical all at the same time.
Right.
And still keep it
under wraps. And holding it together.
Yeah, he has to hold it under wraps.
And he is holding it together because the stakes are so high. This is my only chance to get rid of you, Wilma.
It's like, I got to get the bitch under the stairs. I've got to do it. Please hold it. Don't let me blow it.
And he knows her so well that he knows that if he tells her that story, that she's so curious.
Oh, of course. Because she delights in other people's misery.
Well, now he's found the key right there. He's found the key, and he's like,
and then of course Fluffy doesn't come out right away, anyway.
Right.
What are you doing, Harry?
Since right here you want Fluffy to jump out and just grab her, you know?
But
right.
Fluffy's just like, I'm full. I really don't need anything else at this point.
Oh no, it has to go through this thing. He's like, you know, he's figuring, come on, come out, come out, wherever you are.
He's actually bouncing her off the crate to wake Fluffy up.
Wake up, wake up.
Now he's never seen Fluffy at this point.
No, so at this point it could all be a bunch of
crap.
He doesn't know.
Wait!
But that could be something in Dexter's head.
Well, but the blood, you know.
But still, you know.
And now she still deballs him here.
Oh, completely. Just humiliating.
Literally makes a reference to his balls, you know.
I swear to God, I'm going to wear your balls for earrings.
Actually, Fluffy's going to wear.
Her performance in this moment is just absolutely priceless.
Cause whap, whap,
just,
whap.
Just unloads on the
show. He's thinking, oops. Might I have made a mistake here?
It's like, I really...
am I still doomed?
That's his lowest moment right there.
Right.
It's just like, oh God, nothing's I'm going to be stuck with this woman for the rest of my life.
And now she's been hit with a purse. So instead of verbal abuse, it's now going to be physical from this point on.
No good at making an impression
Oops.
On
him. Poor guy.
He had it in within his grasp.
Well,
the last time you got it up, Henry.
He may have been right after all.
Well, wait, no, he takes the lock off.
Yeah,
earlier he takes the lock off. Yeah, that's in the earlier scene. And that was another shocker. Whoa, look at this. Ah, look at these scrims behind their heads.
His outrageous, huh?
He's disgusted and happy at the same time.
But look at this. Hal had to stand there, had to sit there and stay in the moment. And so did Adrienne. While we put these scrims up, set them up. And they, you know, the moment never breaks. They continued the performance as though it was, you know, seamless.
Right. Because they're not even acting to Fluffy. They're not even looking at what they're supposed to be seeing.
Fluffy was not there.
Yeah.
Do you remember the remains of Adrienne?
That shot's not even in.
No, it's not in here. No.
Not in the movie.
But he's got plenty of shots of it.
Just floats out of the crate at the end.
Yeah, in the end, when the crate is submerged, her face floats up to the surface. And we never really got it. We shot it in that tank, and it never looked deep enough.
It was hard to get that to rise face first, you know.
Yeah. So we decided that we didn't need it. But there was this shot that we shot in the same tank that Ted Danson... Oh, here's the lock thing. I'm sorry.
Okay. This is where you expect him
putting it right there.
And it's a microsecond later.
Yeah.
And this little click of the lock. That was also an audience jump. And he just
barely gets it over. Yeah.
When swing it around, clink.
Clink.
Made it. It's
the crate works extremely well.
It really works very well.
I mean, it has you on the edge of your seat and has you just delighting in the performances of all these people. And
that's the thing. It's the people that bring it to life. I mean, it's the actors that always bring it to life.
Yeah.
And now it's Greg Nicotero's son's toy chest.
Really?
Yeah.
What?
It's his toy chest.
Oh, is that what he uses the crate for?
Well, he has the crate now. And it's
he has the crate. You mean he's actually using the crate as his son's toy chest?
It's his son's toy chest. Well, Rubenstein does the same thing in his apartment. It's his daughter's toy chest.
You're kidding.
Yeah, one of the big crates.
Oh, yeah.
There's a miniature one somewhere.
Are they still bloody?
Yeah. The whole front of it is
drenched,
dried old red blood.
Where did they go? I mean, how much could it eat?
This stuff, I remember trying to shoot these things. This is poor man's process. We're in a studio. We're actually not driving. And these things, this was another matte painting of the...
Mike has a great shot of that, a whole wide shot of just the slab, empty on both sides.
Is that right?
And then the movie, of course, you see...
The whole painted rider's quarry. This, the quarry.
Now, when it hits the water, it's a miniature crate in falling into that water tank that Ted Danson was in.
This is a matte painting.
Yeah.
The quarry's a matte painting. But that's a miniature in the water.
But we have shots of Hal dropping that into a big canvas tarp.
Like, yeah.
A trampoline, actually, it looks like.
Later.
That same day.
There's no evidence of foul play.
I love that stuff. I mean, it's so campy and silly.
But it
doesn't destroy the... You know, despite everything that we did with all that stuff later, meanwhile, bada boom, all the comic book headlines and everything, it doesn't destroy it because the performances hold up. And it's just like in a comic book. I remember reading those comic books.
Yeah.
And it would be silly. The Crypt Keeper would say silly sayings all that, but the story was the story. And straight-faced.
Well, it also reminds people that it's a comic book.
Yeah.
I love how now he's totally confident. And
yeah. But he still gives him a little one-upman, you know, right here. How do you know I won't go? What are friends for?
It's like, I haven't done anything to anybody.
Look at this simultaneous sit-down.
I intend to kick your ass at chess for the rest of your
another
life.
Beautiful set by Cletus.
Neither have I.
And Fritz is just now beginning to come around.
He's a little worried here.
It's like my former friend, who I thought I understood, has really gone over the edge.
Try to watch a CSI program where they figure out what happened to Adrienne. You can't. There's no
evidence.
Evidence.
Yes, it's like Well, according to the evidence, strictly speaking, hey, she would have had to have been eaten by a creature in a box.
We found her face. And there's some really weird DNA that we can't identify at all.
Yeah. So this one's going to be a cold case from now on.
It looks like a Tasmanian devil, this DNA.
Yeah, but that's just silly. If this shot had continued, we would have seen her face probably flying out.
Bloop, bloop.
Right there. Yeah. That's where it was supposed to be. And we wound up using these eyes, the repeat shot of the eyes that happened.
So what does he do? Does he swim to shore and then live off the land for a while?
Oh, or finds another box to sit in.
See, this is why we should make a sequel.
Mm. Find out where did Fluffy go?
Well, he goes somewhere. He goes to,
He goes to Starbucks.
He evolves.
Like everybody else does.
He evolves,
days.
Right.
Oh, boy.
Oh, man. Here we go. My man, E.G.
I just remember...
What a pro. I mean, when we met E.G., I mean, this is a guy that had been in 1,000 movies and TV series and all that, and he came in and I'm sort of a little intimidated, and he turned out to be this regular guy. He said, he's a journeyman.
Yeah.
Actor.
Well, remember him on The Defenders?
Defenders, yeah. A Plautus production.
And there is...
The ashtray.
The ashtray as a soup dish.
Okay.
So we got four out of five. We didn't get Jordy Vero, but for everyone else at home, you find it in Jordy Vero.
Yeah, find it in Jordy, and
please tell
you get the prize.
You get the prize. You get
I
to
ain't
say
saying
you
what
found.
The prize is.
Well, we'll get Chris Devrakis to send him an ashtray.
Chris is going to hear that and go, oh, no.
You know, I almost drove up here. I almost brought him along as a film historian, Chris Devrakis.
Exactly, yeah. I mean, it looked like E.G. Marshall was just having the time of his life with this dialogue. I mean, it was just...
Well, he loved the dialogue and loved being a mean son of a bitch and all that, but it was hard. I mean, it was hard. It was tough on him because we had to, say, okay, stand still, and we're going to put these roaches on you.
And he let the roaches be on.
He let them crawl on
him. He let them crawl on him.
Man,
but this was this tiny little set, basically, and we almost didn't shoot this because we had run out of money. We've discussed that before, but there are a lot of shots like that shot of the telephone, this shot, which enabled E.G. to relax. He didn't have to do all the speeches,
Right.
He didn't have to do the whole 10 pages.
Right, because it's him talking to a phone. I mean,
it's him talking to a phone. So if you show a shot of the phone, he doesn't have to, okay, we can break here and you can pick up the next speech.
Now, the people on the phone, do you remember who played some of the voices on the phone?
Well, I remember Ann Muffley, I think.
Now, she's Mrs. Katzenmeier.
Yeah.
Now, they credit on the IMDb, someone thinks it's Gwen Verdon.
Oh, you're kidding.
Yeah.
No, it was Ann Muffley.
Although it sounds like her, I can see how they might think that.
I thought it was Galen.
No, it was an actress named Ann Muffley. Bob Trowe, one of... Reach Cortex's old company was one of the voices. I think they may be the only two. How many people?
There were three people. David Early actually has a voice, but we see him. So there's George Gendron and Mrs. Katzenmeier.
Yeah.
I remember a meeting on the set where you actually asked all of us if we thought we should do the fifth episode, if we could gear up to actually, do all the stuff.
Get it together, yeah. Well, I know it was really under question there for a while. It was purely budgetary.
Yeah.
And I'm so glad.
That we did it.
It's
a
amazing.
Topper.
It's the climax. The
icing on the cake.
Oh, yeah.
And everyone talks about this episode.
Yeah.
I like The Crate, and I like They're Creeping Up on You. I mean, those are, I think, terrific stories. And at the time, everybody was saying, those stories are so good, you don't need anything else. And I was arguing that, but this is so outrageous, and people are going to remember this,
Oh, yeah. To come after the crate, which is an extremely strong story, to have something like this.
Yeah.
Which is.
You don't know where it's going.
No, you don't.
Roaches. It can handle roaches, just a couple of roaches. But then that couple turns into 28,000,
Yeah.
And then the final twist with E.G.
There is a phobia.
Oh.
So this movie
this movie gave me a fear of roaches.
I never picked one. Did you ever pick one of those roaches?
I was never in
these guys,
room.
The entomologists would go, like in these scenes where there was only one roach,
right.
They'd come in and just pick it up. Like it was a pretty pet cat or something. They'd pick it up. And they'd say, here, hold this for a minute. And I'd say, not me.
Just the idea of those legs. The idea of those scurrying legs on you.
You just don't want to have that in your hand, all that scratching.
Oh, no.
Bastards.
And what they did was they used, CO2 to sort of,
I don't know,
slow them down. They didn't, it wasn't, they used, I think, CO2.
Just to kind of make them a little.
Sort of make them a little groggy.
Uh-huh. Cold.
For shots that when we needed them to
stay still,
be on his robe for a while.
It would slow them down. The cold would slow them down. Yeah.
So they would move, but they weren't. Because boy, when they move, when they're without the CO2, when they move, they're gone. And
I think I remember them actually putting them in a refrigerator freezer, and then taking out like a tray or a Tupperware thing of them, and they would be slower.
Yeah.
But, we should talk about the entomologists. They actually went to Trinidad and collected 18 or more thousand roaches and bred.
Give me a break. 250,000.
And they would breed them in this trailer that we spoke about earlier. And the trailer was called the Roach Motel. We called it the Roach Motel. Yes.
The Roach Coach.
And they collected these roaches by digging big holes in bat guano, bat shit, in caves in Trinidad. Turn off the lights, the hole would fill up, turn the lights back on, load them into plastic bags,
Yeah. They sent photographs back where they were waist deep in roaches. Just this sea of, like the last scene in this story, they were just that deep.
That deep.
And Ray said the bats in the caves where the roaches were don't use their sonar because they know the cave. So if you're standing in the way, you get a bat in the face. And he said that the bat died, fell, and the roaches turned it inside out before they ate it.
Well, I'll remember that.
It's just something that...
That's gross.
Yeah,
that's the power of...
A million roaches
to send. A million roaches.
Yeah.
No, it was amazing, man. And the thing is, they're actually not dirty insects. Everyone thinks that they're dirty. They're not. They clean themselves and they shed. Now, let me tell you, the set stank.
Oh, I
often
bet. Yeah.
Because when they freak, they drop everything. They shit. They drop their eggs. They drop everything.
Well, you can
inside.
See in the movie. There's roach turds all over the place in some of the shots.
So that they lighten their load, and so they can move even faster. Not that you can catch them even when they was loaded. But and that's what it actually stank like an elephant house, because there were so many of them, freaking out.
So we've worked with roach shit, monkey shit.
With all kinds of
on monkey shots.
We work with animals. Animals are us. Are
we together on? We supplemented the roaches though with peanut shells painted black.
Goodbye. Well, in the huge
the
mass
stuff,
scenes.
And the kitchen stuff.
Yeah.
It's like the one bit of personality in this whole place is that jukebox. It's the only thing that's got any real...
Well, it's amazing. I love the idea of having this little old Wurlitzer in there. Yeah. A little bit of color.
Yeah.
But it's old, sad, it makes you sort of sad. The it's old like, songs in this context.
Mm-hmm.
I could sit here and listen to old jazz, for all night. But in this context, when it's all this guy has, there's something sad about it.
Yeah, it's his rosebud. It's his sled. That's that it. He's,
exactly.
You know.
And it was great.
Also, he's gone through so much trouble to keep this hermetically sealed environment, you know.
And it's perfect because it's all white, so whenever one little roach shows up, it just stands out.
Yeah.
It's an invasion. It's a very, it's such an affront to this guy.
Did the screenplay do that, or did you do that?
It was definitely in the screenplay. It was an all-white Howard Hughes kind of hermetically sealed environment, you know. But Cletus, again, you know, came up with it, built it. This stuff, this was, I thought it was amazing. Amazing scene.
Yeah, you just have to kind of shoot and hope the roaches go somewhere where you want them to go at the end of the day.
There's nothing you can do, except there's David Early.
Yep.
In a cameo role.
It's Mr. White.
Mr. White. There's nothing you could do. I mean, when we got these shots later of the roach, we found out the entomologist told us that a roach won't cross a Vaseline line. So when we needed shots of roaches coming at us, we would draw two Vaseline lines and dump them out, and they would crawl towards us, and they wouldn't cross the Vaseline line, so you could find a focus on it. The thing is, with a camera, when you focus on a point with a long lens, you literally are focusing on a, you know, 1 inch of turf. And so they would pass through this, but at least you got some images, like these really tight shots, like the earlier one of that roach coming around the corner.
All right.
You had to put a diopter on the lens, and the focus range is so limited that, you know, if it moves 1 inch the wrong way, you don't
have nothing. Yeah.
So we have to keep shooting until we got it.
Well, you got some great close-ups of in focus of roaches.
Yeah, a couple.
And there's a great shot when he throws the sheet back of the roaches rushing up to him, and I imagine that's how you accomplish that, was with that Vaseline, just to kind of funnel them towards the camera.
Well, in that case, I think they were just there. We just loaded them. And a lot of those were the fake ones, the peanut shells.
Oh, yeah.
And you know, so it looks like more than there are, because many had escaped. I mean, we would... Look at this fake lightning. I'm sorry. What? Sorry, guys. Looked pretty fake.
Yeah, that's the mantra. It's a comic book.
Okay. Oops. Light's going out.
Oh, that's the worst thing. Not only are you with roaches, but
it's
in
the
dark. You don't know where they are.
What brings them out, is the power going out. They don't like light. Oh, man. Goddamn. Yeah, we're about to see some big mothers coming up.
Bastards!
That's amazing. How did we do that, Tom? I mean, I think we just sort of forced them up through a...
Well, that vent thing, I think, is the funnel that you were talking about earlier, where they dumped them, and they all... But eventually, I guess...
They came out.
Some came out, yeah. I think the drain in the sink was a big syringe like we had later on.
Yeah. All over the place. We would try to put them around. You dump a Rubbermaid 10-gallon garbage can out of full of roaches into this room, and within 20 seconds you don't see one. They find places to hide.
That big one that went by.
Big guy. Yeah.
Well, there's one that crawls out of the exhaust chute there later on. That's enormous. Looks like it ate five other bugs.
Well, that was a Steve.
That was a Steve. You know,
each one of these shots, though, we would have to. Mike would focus on the phone here, and they dump the.
Oh yeah, you can see they're beginning to dissipate even as
they dump 100 of them in there, thousands of them in there, and they within 20 seconds they'd be gone. They'd get inside that phone. So, I mean, it was amazing. All of these, each one of these shots had to be refreshed. You know, you had to dump new roaches in. So they would show up.
I remember you asked them to redesign this console. Maybe not that in particular, but you wanted the more science fiction-y or something. Now that's a bunch of peanut shells with roaches on it.
Yeah.
Here comes one out of the appearance shot with the huge. Oh, look at that big mother! He was.
Yeah, that big guy.
That's the bird eating.
That's the blabberous gigantic. Now that sink is obviously not full of roaches. It's got a fake bottom. But we had 250,000 roaches.
Wow. Oh, I had no idea there were that many.
Oh yeah. And when you buy them from a catalog, they're 50 cents a piece. So that adds up. That's like $125,000.
Did you ever balance out?
It's cheaper to send these boys down to Trinidad and get us some roaches.
That's what I was wondering. Did you ever balance out what it cost to send those guys to Trinidad?
Yes, we did. Of course. Of course.
Imagine crossing the border. Hi, we have a couple hundred thousand cockroaches. Do you mind?
Yeah.
On the plane, how do you get...
Well, when they came back across the border, they basically said, this is for a Stephen King movie. And the border guards said, oh, Stephen King? Sure. Let him through.
Right this way.
Go ahead and ruin the environment.
You're going through customs. Right. What's in there? That's that
shot of them rushing.
Depth of field thing you were talking about.
Yeah, yeah. You'd dump them out in front of the lens. You'd focus on a point, 6 inches in front of the lens.
Now, George saved the day when... I mean, we all know the roaches are going to come out of Stephen King. We're not giving anything away. But this is the fifth movie. It was me and a 17-year-old kid that did all the effects and all these things, which is kind of burned out. I could not figure out how to have the roaches come out of V.G. Marshall's chest. George suggested, just make the hole and cover it with toilet paper, make it up like his skin, and that's what we did. And then you did the same thing on Rami getting the obelisk in his chest, two evil eyes. Yeah. Did it with toilet paper, That's just air bladders, and that's an appliance on his forehead. It would just inflate in the shape of a roach. Here they come. That's the toilet paper right there.
Yeah.
Now, if you were running the sound on the set, we're screaming.
Oh yeah.
We're screaming at how when they came out of there.
Well, because they were actually coming out. Yes. And there were hundreds of them.
Oh yeah, on that footage time, I remember you go. That's wonderful.
Yeah, and then he cracks up. That's the last thing in the tape. Well, they're not just creeping up on you. They're creeping out of you.
So now we're spread a little more Rick Catazone over here against the camera.
Okay, now watch. In the distance, it's Marty Schiff and me as garbage men. And we're doing bits. We're kicking lids and catching them and doing acrobatics with the trash cans over there.
Yeah, but then what? You mean it's not highlighted?
Oh, I know. You see it. It's there.
I think, is the Foley wrong? All the sound effects. Marty Schiff and Tom. Here we go.
One of the, Dawn of the Dead, and there's been a few things where Marty and I have been partners in crime.
Partners in crime.
Partners in garbage.
But we must.
This is all ad libbed here too. Oh,
yeah, completely.
Comic book.
Now you never see garbage men like this.
No.
A Jewish guy and.
X-ray glasses.
They don't work. They make your eyes.
Well, that's how it works.
Yeah. But Tom, at the end of the day, we do have to remember that you are garbage man number two.
I reminded Marty yesterday that he's garbage man.
You are garbage man number two.
See, you don't see Voodoo Doll on the 185. It's cropped off.
Didn't you tell me the comic book you saw does have that thing cut out?
It has a little thing cut out still, Where Billy
has... But you don't see it on screen.
Dan, are you
the doll is chopped off. You see Voodoo. Voodoo Doll.
And now... Let me find out that Billy's been up to something.
Yeah.
Show my comic books away, will you?
And there you go.
Yikes.
First little pang.
Yikes.
That's what serves you right.
Blake!
Joe King doing it.
Joe King getting the last word in his his father's.
What's he say there?
All this lighting.
Ready for another shock day?
Chinga 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 chinga. Here comes Harrison's music. We tried to put the lights, you know, we tried to get the lights as blue as we could on that and match it. But, you know, we didn't have the dough to really do it exactly right, but it still cooks.
Yeah. I mean, if you're sitting there going, boy, the lights didn't match, I don't like this movie, something's obviously gone wrong.
Okay.
It's a
really fun movie, man. I mean, it was great checking it out. I wish I could have been listening to it at the same time, but I can't because we're recording this. Had we been listening to it at the same time, we wouldn't have been able to record. It's really, really, it's really fun. We had a great Garbage Man number one, Garbage.
See it? Yeah.
How did you get to be Garbage Man number two?
Why?
Who decided that?
Marty Schiff loves being number one on that. He loves it.
Reminds me constantly.
When I interviewed him, that was the first thing I remember. I'm Garbage Man number one.
And he said, did he say, make sure you tell Tom?
Exactly, yes.
Oh, man. The editors.
Also, Pat Buba did Geordi. And Mike Spolin did. I had it backwards. Shows you what I know.
No, yeah. I didn't think that was right.
Yeah. And you were right.
Yeah. Jim Fang. There's this story about Jim Fang. We were looking at these. We watched this movie, and we're sitting there looking at the credits in a screening room, dark screening room. And, you know, this was the first movie where there were, you know, 125 people that worked on it. And I didn't know half of them, nor their names. Mm-hmm. And we're sitting in the screening room the first night that we showed it, and all these credits came up. And I happened to focus on Jim Fang's name. And it was a random thing. Mm-hmm. And I said, look at this, all these people worked on this movie. And I said, like, who the hell is Jim Fang? And Jim was sitting right
there. Oh.
And he turned around and he said, that would be me.
Oh, man. Of all the names to pick, that's the one that you got.
Yes, but he went on to work on Monkey Shines right. And Dark.
He obviously didn't hold it against you.
No, he didn't hit me or anything.
But who the hell is Jim? Here.
Here I am.
Present.
Thanks for noticing me, George.
You know, it's just one of those pick it out of the hat. Yeah. I'm looking at this list of credits.
Yeah, it could have picked anybody.
Yeah, but George, if you're in a room, clearly he's the only one that could be Fang. He's Chinese, you know, he's or Korean or something. You know.
Where there weren't any others? Yeah, maybe.
Well, I don't know. I wasn't there. I'm just thinking, you know.
So we've been watching Creepshow here with George Romero and Tom Savini. I've had a lot of fun. I hope you've had too. Guys, want to say your goodbyes here?
How do you say that in England?
I don't know.
Buona sera.
So long, mates.
No, that's not British.